set to do these work for these your children. Lord, may every decision made tonight be for the uplift of the children and this community at St. Helena. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I'd like to call the autumn meeting of the St. Louis Parish School Board, regular meeting, October 9th, 2014, 354 Sidney Street, Greensburg, Louisiana. Madam Secretary.
Board roll call. Ms. Joyce Porter.
Present.
Mr. Edward Gallman.
Present.
Ms. Linda Cheney.
Present.
Mr. Willie Lee.
Yes.
Ms. Virginia Bell.
Present.
Mr. Alton Travis.
Here.
All members present, quorum established.
Item C. Approved board minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, you had a chance to digest. What's your pleasure?
I'm so moved, Mr. President.
It's been moved by Mr. Travis and second by Ms. Porter. Any questions thereof? Vote.
Ms. Porter?
Yes.
Mr. Gallman?
Yes.
Ms. Cheney?
Yes.
Mr. Lee?
Yes.
Ms. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Travis?
Yes.
Six yeas, motion carried.
Item D. Approve the agenda.
I so moved.
It has been moved by Ms. Porter, second by Ms. Cheney. Any question?
Yes, sir.
Madam Secretary.
Ms. Porter?
Yes.
Mr. Gallman?
Yes.
Ms. Cheney?
Yes.
Mr. Lee?
Yes.
Ms. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Travis?
Yes.
Six yeas, motion carried.
And that brings us to item E, the superintendent's report. Madam Superintendent.
Good evening, Board. I just have a few announcements. First, I want to talk to you about several things. The first is Act 833. This is a new law that has been put into place as of August 1st that deals with our LIHTC students. And our LIHTC students are students that are on track to receive a certificate of achievement. That has now changed. Act 833 allows these students to receive a high school diploma. There are some issues when we talk about the federal guidelines, IDEA, and how it relates to this law. But we are working toward making sure that we are giving our students what they need in order to receive the high school diploma. If you look within the packet, I did highlight some things on page 3 of 8. It talks about the criteria for students to qualify for Act 833. Of course, we would love to have all of our students earn their top scholarship, you know, where they receive, they get a high school diploma toward TOPS or a Core 4. We do want our students to receive an IDC, some type of high school diploma that is recognized by the state and also recognized by the federal government. Act 833 poses some issue with that, but I believe that through Ms. Reno's department that we can follow the letter of the law and give our students what they need prior to the State Department giving out guidance. And that's the issue, the State Department not giving clear guidance on what needs to be done with this. And in all fairness to the State Department, the law did become active August 1st, so they needed, you know, they need that time to figure out just how to proceed properly when dealing with Act 833. So I just wanted to make you aware that we are working toward ensuring that our students are serviced properly under this new law. I do serve on the steering committee, so I get the first-hand knowledge, first-hand information about how this is progressing with the State Department. The next thing is Act 3. Act 3 is something that also came from the State Department. It deals with early childhood. And I have Ms. Fields Gutierrez, who will come up and explain very, very briefly about where we are with Act 3.
Good evening, Board. We have been partnering with East Feliciana on this Act 3 initiative. The State Department is offering a cohort of sorts to which we can apply for funding. We are eligible for up to $50,000. East Feliciana is eligible for up to $80,000. So combined, we would get up to $130,000. It would basically be used to train our early childhood teachers both here in East Feliciana at Head Start, Quadier at Head Start in East Feliciana, as well as the Class 8 daycares. We have one here in St. Helena, it's called Blooming Faces, and there's two in East Feliciana. And that would ensure all at-risk four-year-olds receive the equitable education. So no matter if they go here, or if they're in Head Start, or if they're at daycare, excuse me, child care, they will have the same, all the teachers will have the same training, they'll use the same curriculum, they'll be held to the same standards. So we had a meeting on Tuesday at the College and Career Academy for East Feliciana and St. Helena, and it was a wonderful turnout. We had about 50 people who came from just different organizations, all pledging their support, whether it's some pastors saying, you know, we're going to get the word out to the people in our congregation to, you know, they've got to get their babies in school, they've got to get their four-year-olds in school. People from DHH were there with, oh my gosh, I just had someone ask me the other day about, you know, what they can do with their infant, and I had no idea what to tell them. Head Start takes kids at 6 weeks. So just, if anything, educating everybody about getting our young children from birth to five educated and getting them quality education. So it's really exciting. We're putting together our application now. It's due November 12th, but we hope to have it together, written, and sent off by the end of the month because it's a rolling application. So it's a good turnout. We're excited.
And while Ms. Gutierrez is there, I want to also ask if she talks about the Power Up Your Athletic program.
So driving to work one day, I was listening to the radio, and this commercial came on for, hey, win $4,000 for your athletic program. Use it for uniforms, equipment, whatever you want. So I approached our athletic director, Coach Brown, and I said, let's do a video for St. Helena College and Career Academy. They got to give us the money, right? We're going to win. So we did a quick video. It was about 2.5 minutes, and it just highlighted our program, what we have, what's great about St. Helena. And we submitted it, and we should know the results by Halloween. So we're very hopeful that we will win this through WAFB. So they said check their website, and you know, hopefully to get an email, because I sent it off. The deadline was the 29th of September, so we're just waiting to hear back. We'd love to use that, because Coach Brown said they will be doing girls softball, girls volleyball, and boys baseball, which are three brand new sports, so they'll need to fund the equipment and the uniforms for those sports this year.
I'm confident we'll win because Ms. Gutierrez did a very good job in creating that video. She just took it, you know, took the bull by the horn and just went with it. So I'm confident that we will be successful in that. And because we're St. Helena, we're just like,
yeah,
it's going to be great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Also, I want to turn your attention to the next item. Well, it's not listed, but I do have this progress report I wanted to share with you all. A lot of times we forget all of the hard work that was put into where we are today as a district. And what this progress report does, it tells the community exactly all of the things that we've done. It's easy to see, you know, the progress with the new facilities coming up and all of that, but it's what you don't see is what's listed in this progress report. So it's just a synopsis of all of the things that we've accomplished. And we also have to know, Mr. Douglas said as well, is that we do forget. But we're forgetting because now the conversation has changed. We've laid the foundation, a good solid foundation for the school district. And so now what we're doing is now building upward. And that with that comes a different type of conversation. So now our conversation isn't about how do we close this deficit. Our conversation is now about how do we improve curriculum and instruction in the classroom? How do we get our teachers motivated? How do we maintain our teachers? You know, what other things can we do in the classroom that will have a positive impact on student achievement? So in that new conversation, it's like we're in a new phase. And so being in this new phase, I wanted to just take a moment to look back and show the progress that we've made up to this point. So this is the progress report. I also wanted to share with you the College and Career Guide. Dr. Vaughn, you know, came in, hit the ground running, and although this is the second year of it, because of Jumpstart and all of the other changes that have occurred, and because now we're College and Career Academy, this whole document had to change. So now every student received the College and Career Guide, and in it, it has tons of information about what they need to do at this point, and then what they need to do post-secondary. So this is a huge thing. And they used this 2 weeks ago to create their five-year plan. So every student has now a five-year plan. And now that you want to get up and explain some of the personal experiences you had, because the kids absolutely love this, the program that you had put on at the school. Very briefly.
Good evening, Board. We met with each individual grade level. We shared with them some expectations that it's not just a name change. We're actually requiring them to get ready for post-secondary. And our little girl told us, well, I thank God that you did this because I didn't know if I was going to graduate, because she had left and she came back. But we told her, yes, we have a plan for you, so she was able to put a plan in place to make sure that she graduates. And the word has gotten out. Students are seeing me in the hall, and I can hold them accountable when I walk into that classroom and say, well, you told me you was going to graduate on time. And kids, I took pictures. They were really excited about knowing what their next steps would be. And they were excited to know that now they can go to the technical college, the eighth grade especially. We're excited about knowing that their senior year would be filled with college level
students. So it's no coincidence that we have our eighth graders taking English 1, Algebra 1, Spanish 1, and Health. We want to make sure that their junior, senior year is open for the opportunities for dual enrollment, advanced placement, and all of the other things that are afforded to them following this track. So I want to thank Dr. Vaughn for doing a great job with this college and career guide. The next thing is our Turnaround Arts Initiative on Monday. This coming Monday, we will have actress Alfred Woodard. She will be here in the parish at St. Helena Arts and Technology Academy. As stated before, that school is an arts turnaround school through the George Rodrigue Foundation, the Louisiana A+, and also through the President's Committee of the Arts and Humanities. So she will be in town to give us the kickoff ceremony. So she'll be coming in at 11 o'clock, and we'll have all kinds of wonderful activities for her. She'll present, and she will work with a few kids while she's here and go around and take a tour of the school and see the things that we've done up to this point. So this is our celebrity artist that will be working with the students of St. Helena Arts and Technology Academy. So we're very proud of that. So if you have the opportunity to come, please make sure you are there. We'll have a special seat waiting for you. In addition to that, that's my last comment tonight, the Dow partnership has extended. We do receive the Dow Promise grant every year of $10,000. We'll be using those funds to purchase equipment for the new science lab at the College and Career Academy, and also some things at the Arts and Technology Academy. But now we also have, for our 5th through 8th graders, you know, we now have those grade levels back, we'll be providing them with what's called First Lego, where they'll be creating robotics and entering competitions with other, you know, against other schools. And then also You Be the Chemist, where the kids will participate in another competition where they learn and understand the field of chemistry. So those are two big pieces that we are trying to incorporate in our middle grades. And that concludes my report.
Awesome. Item F, instruction update. Basically, we've kind of been over that.
Yeah.
We just through the update. I'll set most of the effect.
Okay.
I'm going
to move.
We've been moved by Ms. Bell and second by Ms. Porter. Any questions? Madam Secretary?
Ms. Porter?
Yes.
Mr. Gallman?
Yes.
Ms. Cheney?
Yes.
Mr. Lee?
Yes.
Ms. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Travis?
Yes.
6 yeas, motion carried.
Item G, the committee reports. We had, we can actually do that collectively if it's the board pleasure. In the move by Ms. Cheney, question by Mr. Lee.
Second.
I'm sorry. Second by Mr. Lee. Any questions? Madam Secretary.
Ms. Porter?
Yes.
Mr. Gallman?
Yes.
Ms. Cheney?
Yes.
Mr. Lee?
Yes.
Ms. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Travis?
Yes.
Six yeas, motion carried.
Item H, next meeting date, the committee meeting will be November 13, 2014, at 5:45 p.m. Regular board meeting, November 13, 2014, at 6 p.m. School Board Central Office, 354 Sippin Street, Greensburg, Louisiana. I was supposed to say that there are no cards, and therefore, there will be no...
I got time to... Can I have one real quick?
What do you want to talk about?
Just wanted to share with the board, because based on everything that was shared and the things that were brought up, there's a lack of communication in the community. That's the reason why the calls come or whatever happens, or things are not communicated properly, and a lot of the questions come up. So I'm asking the board, who represents us? I am in the community, and I stand before you as not an employee, but a person in the community.
Who are you, sir?
Amos Chandler.
Chandler.
Yes, ma'am. That you, I don't know. I really don't. I don't have the answers. And I thank God I'm not so educated where I don't see everything or know everything. But here you need to listen to your people. Whether that's go to the school, whether that's have a one-on-one with each teacher, I don't know. The custodians, everybody has their own individual issues, but a lot of them feel like they're not being heard by y'all. And I don't know, but I was taught and raised. People either love to see you come, or they're gonna love to see you go. And that makes a big difference. No matter what you accomplish or what you're doing in life, that makes a big difference how people really feel about you. But they need to hear, they need to feel that y'all care. They don't feel like they have a voice through y'all. And that hurts.
Okay, well, if you have any ideas how we can get to the people, there's limited communications here, you know.
Right.
Mass
communication. I mean, but we
can... have to take them on a, you know, one-on-one, and if you don't know how to reach them,
I mean, even if, I mean, because we could communicate real well to pass taxes, which was needed.
Right.
I mean, the superintendent, beautiful, and I've been telling her from day one, beautiful vision there. You know, there's a lot of things we can accomplish, but there's much more we can do other than what's been done or being done. But it takes that connection that you all are supposed to have because you represent us. All six of y'all represent however many thousands of individuals are in this community. And when you have students and adults that have little to no confidence in y'all, that's not a good thing.
Let me say this, Mr. Anderson. I agree with what you're saying. But one thing I do find out, especially people here, we act on too much of hearsay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And doing this, acting on hearsay, you don't come to find out nothing was going on. We don't try to find out. Somebody say something negative over here, we take it wrong. Mm-hmm. And this over here, but we got to get our people educated to the fact that we go out and find out what's going on, learn by reading. Now, who knows about this lady being here Monday? But they come up with some kind of big... Let me tell you something somebody told me not long ago, that the carpenters down here said they weren't going... We had to come in and put a change on. Show you how things get out. We had to come in and put a change on. I get a call that... The carpenter was talking about, you don't see no more shingles being put on. You don't see no bricks being laid. The car stopped by there and the carpenter told me he wasn't going to do no more brick. He ain't going to do more shingles until they get their $19,000. It's not kind of laying about you. I do what the hell you're talking about. You know, what are you talking about? You're going to get your $19,000. That's what now, boy, you need to come and see. We were talking about a change order. Somebody carried out on. That's why this come when you don't know something. Listen to find out. Our time coming fast.
That's what they know.
Come on. So, and Ms. Chairman, I guess it's different from a lot of, I don't know whether you see me in the community, but people see me. And people do approach me, attack me, the whole nine yards, all the time. But one of the things I do want to say, that thanks to Dr. Joseph, we recall and put every one of these board meetings on the web. All they have to do is, you know, in other words, that's in a place where where communication is weak. We basically put this on the web. And as far as me myself, being visual in second district, I work in this community. I'm on the ground on a regular basis. And trust me, I don't know whether if somebody don't approach me because they maybe have some fears or anxieties about it. But most people don't have that. And most people, I'll tell you from my own perspective, I hear these conversations. I hear these, but I want to also remind you that in different from boards before, this board has, in the last 3 years, given raises to everybody in the system, from the giant to the bus now to everybody involved. I'm one of these people that, because I work in the community, people are at my office on a regular basis, come to my office because they have concerns about what's going on at these schools. I walk on that campus, which you see me on that campus. I'm on that campus on a regular basis. I have to literally tear away from people because they forget about that I'm got a job to do, other place to be too. I come on that campus and they want to talk about whatever. And I remind them all the time, my phone number, if you got it, you can pass it out to somebody else. I don't mind. And people do call me and talk. So more and more, if any of the board members are not doing that, then that's upon those board members to let their phone numbers be out there, be more visible, and be willing to engage these people, because you know, I'm willing to engage them, and I get beat up a lot of times, but we want to be seen. I want to be seen with as a person that's trying to make a difference for these children. But I want you to remind people that these board meetings are on that web. They can look at any board meeting in the last year in its entirety on that web.
But you have a lot of individuals that don't have access to that. You may have a lot that do, but what about the ones that don't?
More and more.
The board meeting is
wide. More and more. Yeah. Everybody.
But it's the same excuses that we get at the school. No transportation to come to the board. No internet to do online classes.
They can read the meetings in the newspaper. I can tell you this, Mr. Chandler, that St. Helena is well represented in a lot of places. On the 833 Steering Committee, on the Capital Area United Way Board of Directors, at the Superintendent's Regional Meetings, on LSDA, LAS, there's a bunch of acronyms, lots of organizations that, you know, in the job of being superintendent, I'm able to go out and meet with different organizations, different school boards, and the one question that always comes up, first they say, you all are doing a great job in St. Helena. Y'all are on the ball, y'all moving, y'all are doing some great things. So everyone outside of St. Helena is seeing the progress, and they're very excited for us. The question that they ask is, well, how's your board? And I always have to tell them, because it's the truth, not just because you all are here, this is the best school board in the state of Louisiana. Why? Because they allow me to do the job that I need to do, and a lot of that is making tough decisions, but it's all toward improving student achievement. It's all about students. There's never been a decision that's been made that was not about improving student achievement. And like I said earlier, through our progress report, you can see the work that the board has done. You can see the things that's happening now. We've laid the foundation. And a lot of times, people don't get to see the foundation being laid. What they do see is that structure being built. They're starting to see those things. And then you'll start seeing student achievement on paper improve as well. Because St. Helena is the most improved in the history of accountability in Louisiana. The history of accountability in Louisiana. That's huge. So we have made a lot of progress. Just read the progress report and you'll see. But I can tell you that everywhere I go, there's nothing but positive praise about St. Helena. nothing but positive praise. And I always have to say, I have a well-functioning board. We do. You don't see us arguing about anything. You don't see a lot of, you know, all of that craziness that you see with other boards. There's no infighting. There's nothing. It's a well-run school board. And so that is what a community needs, a well-run school board, not a board that is always at each other's throat and not making right decisions for children.
And Mr. Chandler, do not think that Dr. Joseph and I do not disagree behind closed doors. Do you think that Dr. Joseph, that Scott Gomer agrees with everybody anytime, anywhere? No.
No.
But
I'll answer that.
But I'll tell you this, and you saw me at the ball game. You know what happens when I go to a football game? I barely can watch the ball game. From family to family, everybody has their concern. Hang the coach. Get rid of all of them. The field's terrible. I hear all those things. But I'm going to be there because at the end of the day, I know that the children and the decision that we make, we try to put children first. And is it a perfect situation? No, because I would turn us into new facilities, A grade, and all the good things above. I flip the switch. But we're not there yet, but I believe the things that we're doing, it really have us on the way. I do.
And we just want those, anyone who is concerned that to know that, and you pass it on to them, that everybody on this board is willing, I think, to talk to their constituents, to meet with their constituents. I know I am. To deal with them anyway, by phone, you know, face to face, however they want to meet. Any way they want to talk.
And I
am. I don't know if I'm speaking for myself, but I am. And I think y'all are too. You know, I think y'all will deal with your own.
And I'll do my best to reiterate that.
Please do.
And I don't know why. I don't know why, because I'm not from here. I don't have no family. And maybe I can approach you all like I do because I'm a pastor and I don't fear nobody but God. But when you got complete strangers that trust me, to trust to tell me stuff that they don't trust to tell people that they have lived and grew up with all their lives, that's a problem. Especially when those individuals that they should be talking to are controlling some things, some very pertinent things, especially within the community. But I backed y'all from day one because I believe that's what God expects me and requires me to do. All I'm telling you is what maybe they're not telling you. You know, if you want me to do an anonymous survey and what these people can put on paper, how they feel or what their gripes and all concerns are, I'm willing to do it. It's not about that, but it's about all of us being on one accord and moving this community forward, black and white.
And, the question comes up, what one thing, if you had said one thing, what would you say is the most pertinent thing that you hear over and over again from people in the field?
They don't care about us. All this is about y'all. All that's going on. And I know, but listen,
that's an excellent opportunity for you as a person that's going to say that. And guess what? It's a part of what we're doing, and you see yourself. How is a building out there for the children about me? How's that about me? How is a track, the first track that will ever come to St. Louis Parish, ever in life, about me? See, in other words, one of the things about, and the biggest problem that we have in Grace, being behind and being without for so long, we have a mindset that not only are we dealing with, making an adjustment for education and for the children, we deal with the mindset of these parents that have never had and have never seen things happen and come to you. I tell you what, I have two opponents from my own community. Regardless of all the trials that we've had, from federal court, from the superintendent of education, standing right there on my first meeting and telling me, guess what, hand me the keys, y'all can't run schools in the St. Louis Parish. All these things, over again. But yet, guess what, we're still here. Things are moving forward. From a facility standpoint, and believe it or not, from a mindset standpoint. Looking at children's faces.
I remember when we had the conversation, and you were part of it, about uniforms, and how drastic it was, a simple white shirt and blue pants. The reality is, we have young men out there wearing ties and walking with their chest poked out, looking like somebody. And everybody's grown now. But 6 months ago, you had everybody in here talking about it was the worst thing since whatever. One of the things you have to realize with my brother coming from the outside, and one of the blessings that I had coming back to this community, I lived away from here for 15 years. I lived in places where I saw progress unbelievable. If you left, I lived in Dallas, Texas. Leave Dallas for a year and go back. You're bad enough your way around. It's so progressive. It's fast-paced. Everything's moving. Everything's growing. I live in that environment. When I come out of this environment, very difficult for anybody to tell me that we can't have these things for my children.
That's right.
And that's why I'm still in this fight. And guess what? And I've had some bumps on my head because people did not believe that these things could happen. But Mr. Travis is ready to go.
I want to say something.
Please.
You've been talking for 45 minutes. Mr. Lee and I have been here longer than just about anybody in here.
That's right.
And we have seen disgruntled same women pairs before. We've seen this room filled up. I don't know how they get here. Maybe they're walking. But when they're mad, they get here.
That's right.
And to us, this empty room is a bunch of happy people. When people are mad, they get here to talk to us. We're here every second Thursday. If they want to come talk, they come talk. So, to me, I'm seeing successful school board. Because I have sure seen a rail.
And a lot of the employees, they will gripe, but guess what? Employees are expecting to work now. They're expecting to work. They're held accountable, and they will be held accountable.
And if everybody does their job and does well, then you can have it. Don't worry about what other people not doing. Just do what you need to be doing. You know, it's like a church. Church is not built, the church is in you. So the school system is in us. And I think that's what, you know, I think we're all saying the same thing. You brought up some good points. But, you know, as long as we stay on one accord, we'll be successful. And keep the child first.
Yes.
That's, you know, we don't have to agree, but keep the children first.
I want to just make one comment to the gentleman, if I may. From the perspective of the union, as a union representative, the employees many times do not recognize that the laws have changed. The laws are completely different. Dr. Joseph made reference to that in talking about the union negotiations with the school board. And when the laws changed, although the school district and the union has tried very hard to bring up issues in reference to the law, many times the employees either didn't hear it or didn't understand it or didn't want to understand it because they're used to things being a certain way. So from the union perspective, in reference of this discussion, the school district has to work and perform in reference to Louisiana law. So they have done phenomenal. They are working phenomenally and improve, and the superintendent and the employees here in the central office and the schools, and they have done tremendous work. But for those who are complaining, they don't recognize that everything the employees are doing and the school board members are doing has to be done in reference of the law. So some things may not be what an employee may want.
And
I just wanted to add.
And the old way was that you call your board member and your board member get somebody hired. You call your board member and you have an employee that don't want to do what they're supposed to do, and your board member stands up for them and shuts the superintendent down because that employee. But you know what? That happened for so long. Act Two.
Yes, sir.
Basically, Act Two stepped in and said, guess what? That's that person's employee. The federal model has been for years. I serve on federal boards too. The federal model has been for years. You get in trouble when you mess with day-to-day. They call day-to-day discipline, managing, and dealing with employees. That's day-to-day. That's the federal model. The state has now adopted a federal model.
We have, when I have a gripe and I get a phone call from a parent or whatever, I have only one employee, the superintendent. I'll have the principal to call, or call a teacher or whatever. I call the superintendent because that's the new model. And just like anything else, there are methods in place to discipline and deal with us from an ethics standpoint. Once we start to violate the superintendent by having these conversations with employees about certain things and then empowering them to disregard leadership. And that's been a lesson for all boards around this state, because boards have never been used to having to deal with Act 2 that basically has put the emphasis on everything from this board goes via the superintendent. You see that we don't even come and say, hey, we're going to vote to hire Jimmy, we're going to vote to hire John. Act 2 took it off the agenda. It's not even on the agenda.
They took that power out of
their hands. They took that out of our hands. It's not our job. That's called day-to-day. And to get into day-to-day is an ethics violation. Now, can anybody, anyone on this board, have an individual conversation with the superintendent about anything, anytime they want, in private? Not in this room here. Not supposed to happen. Just want you to understand that that's some of the things that we've had to adjust to. Especially Al and Mr. Lee, they went for years. we basically inherited when we came in. The change was happening when this board, us new ones, came in. But the ones that have been here, they even had the old way where they basically, if four people wanted somebody hired, it didn't matter what the superintendent thought. If they had four votes, they didn't have to talk to a superintendent about a job. They was hired.
We used to count who was in my district with a janitor and a bus driver. Now, like I say, you got three, and I don't have one. So it's my time to get one.
But let the record be known. I just have something to say. I am Linda Chaney. I'm District 3 school board member. And I am always, always willing to listen to anybody. I mean, no matter what. And I think, and I believe, and I know that my constituents know that I'm always available to them. Okay?
And I'd like to say the same as Ms. Chaney. I'm District 1. And my phone rings off the hook from District 1 all the way to District 6. I listen to everybody. Sometimes, I'm going to be honest with you, Mr. Taylor. Sometimes I say, oh my God, how do you get my cell phone number? But don't get me wrong. I listen to them. And like Mr. Goldman said, I'm visible. You have seen me at the school. I go, and like he said, it takes me down. I listen. And believe me, you, when I hear something that's not right, Dr. Joseph, am I wrong? I will come to Dr. Joseph. Dr. Joseph, we need to work on this, and we need to work on that. I do. I come to him, and I listen to him. I listen. I really do. I listen. And after saying all this, Pastor Sidney Perkins that was over there a few minutes ago, what we are having at the using the cafeteria for is for his pastor Sidney Perkins. And I'm a church-going woman too, Mr. Tim, and I love the Lord. And that was my pastor and my brother-in-law. And I want you all to come out and support him on October the 19th. If you don't show your face, just give me a donation. Oh, it starts at 3 o'clock.
And I wore my pink tie tonight in reference to and respect to breast cancer awareness month.
Thank you, Mr. Goldman.
I know, and I have family members that have survived, mm-hmm. as well as family members who have passed on. So just wanted to
And your secretary is a survivor. And my secretary is a survivor.
I second.
Is it moved and seconded? All yes.